Last time we started the topic acid bases and buffers. Now proceeding with the same, I shall move to the further concepts. The concept we are going to study is tonicity. Tonicity. Under this we have to study basically two terms. One is isoosmotic solution. As the name suggests, isoosmotic means which is having the same osmotic pressure. Iso means same, and osmotic is related to osmotic pressure. You know what is osmosis? Osmosis it is basically a process which allows or permeates the movement of the solvent molecules from the region of the dilute concentration to the higher concentration. I'll just make your concept clear to you. Say for example, this is a beaker. There is a semi-permeable membrane. As the name suggests, semi means partially, permeable means it is going to allow some of the molecules to pass through and it is going to forbid some of the molecules not to pass through. Say this is a concentration of a solution which is quite concentrated, right? And this is the dilute. Now what is going to happen? Concentrated solution means solute is higher and solvent is lesser, right? And dilute means solute is lesser and solvent is higher. So the solvent molecules, they will go to this point to make the concentration gradient zero so that an equilibrium is maintained. So this is osmosis process, and this happens to take place only when there is semi-permeable membrane. Now let us study the concept of isoosmotic solutions. These are the solutions which produce the same osmotic pressure as that of the cell contained in the question, but the solute is permeable through the cell membrane, thereby altering the tone of the cell. For example, 1.8% solution of urea. Now let us come to the another concept, which is isotonic solutions. Now these are the solutions which produce the same osmotic pressure as sort of the cell contained in the question without net gain or loss of water by both solution, provided the cell membrane is impermeable to the solute. Solute cannot move, right? Examples include 0.9% weight by volume of NaCl solution, 5% weight by volume of dextrose solution, and 2% weight by volume of boric acid solution. Students, you need to note one point here, that isotonic is not equal to isoosmotic. Say 1.8% solution of urea is isoosmotic to 0.9% weight by volume solution of sodium chloride. They have the same osmotic pressure, but a 1.8% solution of urea, it causes hemolysis, whereas 0.9% weight by volume of solution does not cause hemolysis because it is isotonic. They both are isoosmotic, but they both are not isotonic. Let us move to the differences between osmolarity and tonicity, which will make your concepts clear. Osmolarity is measure of the osmotic pressure of a given solution. On the other hand, tonicity is a measure of the osmotic pressure gradient between two solutions separated by a permeable membrane. Osmolarity has a unit of osmoles per liter, right? And tonicity is measured in moles per liter. Osmolarity takes into consideration the total number of solute, whether they penetrate or they do not penetrate, all are considered here in osmolarity. Whereas in tonicity, it takes into account the concentration relating just to the non-permeable solute. One more difference exists there, that osmolarity often represents the analysis of a given solution, whereas tonicity is used as a measure of the external environment. Now, how do we basically measure this tonicity? There are broadly two methods. Number one is hemolytic method and the other is cryoscopic method. Hemolytic, let me explain this term to you. Lytic is a term which is obtained from lysis, that is a breakdown, and hemo means related to the blood cells. So this method measures the effect of various solutions of a drug when it is observed on the appearance of red blood cells suspended in those solutions. The other method is cryoscopic method, where isotonicity can be measured from colligative properties of the solution. One of the colligative properties which is most commonly used is freezing point depression. I'll make sure this concept is clear to you. Let us have a look on this figure here. Now, this solution is hypertonic to the red blood cells. We'll just repeat what will happen here. This solution is hypertonic, in which there exist the red blood cells. Now, hypertonic, hyper means high, means the salt is higher, means the solvent is lesser in comparison to what? The cell. I'm going to repeat again. We have suspended the red blood cells in a hypertonic solution. It means hypertonic solutions have high salt concentration in comparison to the cell. High salt, lesser solvent. So, the movement of solvent will be from environment of the cell to the outside. That is what have been shown here. Once water will move outside the cell, cell is going to shrink. Now, reverse will be the case with the hypotonic solution. Let us come to that also. Say, this is the hypotonic solution. Now, these are the cells. This is hypotonic, means the salt is lesser. Once the salt is lesser, means the solvent is higher side. Now, the solvent will move from the solution to the cell, which is going to cause the increase in the size of the cell or the swelling, as shown here. When the solution is isotonic, there is neither a gain nor a loss of any kind of solvent molecules. Other term is isotonic buffered solution. Now, we started in the last lecture that we need to maintain the isotonicity of the solutions so that they become acquainted or they are in the equilibrium with the physiological electrolyte solutions of the body. For that, we need the buffered solution. So, this is what? A solution which maintains the isotonicity as well as the pH as that of the body fluid. In order to make the adjustment, we have two broad methods. Number one is class 1 method, which includes cryoscopic method and sodium chloride equivalent method. Other is class 2 method, which includes White-Vincent method and Sproul method. We shall study one by one all these methods. First is cryoscoping method. It is also called as freezing point depression method. As I told you earlier, this depends upon the colligative property. Fine. The plasma and blood freezing point temperature is 0.52 degrees C in the minus terms. We know that water has freezing point of 0 degrees C. Now, if we are going to add any salt or any solute to the water, the freezing point is going to decrease further. That is why it is called freezing point depression, means the water which used to freeze at 0 degrees C is now going to freeze beyond 0 degrees C. So, that is given here minus 0.52 degrees C. Now, any substance, any dissolved substance in plasma or tear depress the solution of the freezing point below 0.52 degrees C. So, any solution that freezes at this temperature is going to be isotonic with the blood and tear. In order to calculate that, how much solute do we need to add so that we can make a solution isotonic with the blood, we have a formula here which is given as W is equal to 0.52 minus A upon B, where W is weight of the substance that need to be adjusted to make it hypotonic substance in gram. A is the depression of the freezing point of water produced by the medicament already in the solution, right? And B is the depression of freezing point of water produced by 1% weight by volume of the added substance. Let us study with the help of an example here. The question says, how much NaCl is required to render 100 ml of 1% solution of epomorphine hydrochloride isotonic with blood serum? What is the question about? That there is a solution, right? Now, this solution contains what? 1% of solution of the drug. What is the drug here? Epomorphine hydrochloride, right? Is solution mein kya hai? 1% epomorphine hydrochloride hai. Ab hum iske andar kitna NaCl daalein so that ye isotonic ho jaye? This is a question. Did you get that? And the data given in order to solve this, we have that 1% solution of drug has freezing point lowering of 0.08 degree C. Freezing point lowering is generally denoted as delta TF, right? And 1% solution of NaCl has freezing point lowering of 0.58 degree C. This is a data given to you so that you can solve it easily. How are we going to do it? See, in order to make the drug isotonic, NaCl is needed to be added, right? We can make the solution isotonic only if we are going to add NaCl. Now, how much NaCl do we need to add here? That is that NaCl is needed to add to the lower freezing point by 0.52, which is the freezing point depression because of the NaCl, that is the isotonicity with the blood, minus 0.08. So, what is this? 0.44. So, if I say 1% epomorphine upon x is equal to 0.58 upon 0.44. Can I write in this proportionate manner? You can have a look. So, 1 gram of drug and 0.76 gram of NaCl in 100 ml means we have to add 0.76. If you are going to calculate this, we are going to get what? 0.76%. Percentage means anything upon 100. So, we need to add 0.76 gram of NaCl in 100 ml of solution. Clear? Next method is sodium chloride equivalent method. This method was developed by Millen and Selzer. The tonicic effect of the equivalent of sodium chloride is called E value. We denote it by what? E, right? It represents the amount of NaCl which will exert the same tonicic effect as that of the 1 gram of drug. For example, NaCl equivalent, that is the E value, if E value of any drug is 0.25, it means 1 gram of drug will exert tonicic effect equal to 0.25 gram of NaCl. I'll repeat, 1 gram of the drug is having the NaCl equivalent of 0.25, means 1 gram of drug will exert tonicic effect equal to 0.25 gram of NaCl. So, there is the data given regarding freezing point depression and the sodium equivalent of the various drugs. For example, epomorphine hydrochloride has delta TF of 0.08 and E value of 0.14. Boric acid has the delta TF of 0.29 and E value of 0.5. Calcium gluconate has a delta TF of 0.09 and 0.16 at its E value. Pilocarpine nitrate has 0.14 as delta point depression and 0.23 as its equivalent value, and so on. Other way is that we can calculate that E value with the formula help here. This is E is equal to 17 into L iso upon molecular weight. Let us take another example with the help of a numerical here. Say, calculate the approximate E value for a new amphetamine hydrochloride, that is a drug name derivative, with a molecular weight 187. We just did the formula in the previous slide here. E is equal to 17 into L iso upon molecular weight. So, we are going to solve it by this formula itself. E is equal to 17 into L iso, that is given in the data that it has the L iso value of 3.4 and the molecular weight 187. So, just put in this equation and we get the answer of 0.31. Another method is White-Vincent method. This method involves the addition of water to medicament to obtain an isotonic solution, followed by the addition of isotonic buffer solution or preservatives isotonic solution to the required volume. It is calculated by the given formula, where V is equal to W into E1% into 111.1, which is a constant here. What is V here? V is the ml of isotonic solution that could be obtained in W gram of drug in the water. W is what? This is the amount of the drug in the formula. E1% is what we did earlier, that is the NaCl equivalent of the drug. And this 111.1, this is what? This is a constant that could be find from the volume for 1% isotonic NaCl. There is one more method which is called Sproul method. Now, this Sproul method has been derived right itself from the White-Vincent method. The formula is V, which is the same, that is a volume, W, that is amount, into E1%, that is your NaCl equivalent, and 111.1, that is the same constant. We can also write it as V is equal to 33.33 into E1%. E is what? Sodium equivalent. So, these are the various methods to calculate the isotonic buffer solution and their tonicity. Next topic we are going to start in this chapter is major intra and extracellular electrolyte. We know that whenever an electrolyte ionizes, it gives positive and negative ions. So, our body has different electrolytes which play a major role. The body fluid consists of organic and inorganic solution, which basically maintain a homeostasis, that is a balance, right? That balance has to be maintained to be disease free. This is the concentration of the balances of the various components which are maintained, and this also plays role in the regulatory mechanism that control pH, ionic balance, osmotic balance. The various cations which we need to study as per the syllabus and which are there in our body fluids, that includes calcium, magnesium, potassium and sodium, and the anions are chloride and phosphate anions. We shall study these cations and anions one by one. Now, what is the functions of these electrolytes? Why do we need them? What do they do in our body? So, electrolyte, they help in the muscle contraction, they help in the nerve impulses, they help in the cellular signaling, means transferring the messages from one cell to another. They help in the cellular transport of different ions, they help in the excretion of the waste, they help in the maintenance of the pH, and most importantly, they help in breathing. So, we can see they are involved in each and every physiological function of our body. So, we need electrolyte balance to be maintained. First, which we are going to study is the sodium ion or the cation. This is the principal cation in extracellular fluid. We know this is a cell. Now, the content which is outside the cell, this is ECF, extracellular fluid, and the content which is inside the cell, that is intracellular fluid, right? Now, this sodium ion or cation is responsible to maintain osmotic pressure as well as hydration. The movement of sodium is critical in generation of these electrical signals, and it is completely absorbed from the intestinal tract. Excess of sodium is excreted by the kidneys, which make them the ultimate regulator of the sodium content of the body. 80 to 85% sodium is generally reabsorbed in the glomerular filtrate. So, this is what happens to the sodium cation in our body. Now, there are conditions when the sodium ion is lesser or it is higher. If it is lesser, it is called hyponatremia. How does hyponatremia arises? Kaise hota hai ye? Hai na? So, excess urine loss, when urine loss is there, sodium is also excreted, that leads to the hyponatremia. In example of say diabetes, diabetic patient, they have the excess urine loss, excess sodium, and that is going to lead to the hyponatremia. Then another condition is metabolic acidosis. Another condition is Addison's disease with decreased excretion of antidiuretic ADH, antidiuretic hormone, and that is aldosterone, diarrhea and vomiting, as well as kidney damage. These are also the conditions which leads to the hyponatremia. Hypernatremia, when the sodium ion concentration is at the higher side. How did this arise? This arises by hyperaldrinism, that is called as Cushing syndrome, with increased aldosterone production. It also occurs by the severe dehydration. Then the certain types of brain injury that also lead to the hypernatremia. Excess treatment with the sodium salt, they also lead to the hypernatremia. So we study that sodium ion has so much importance. We need to maintain the proper concentration of this electrolyte in our body so that different physiological functions, they run smoothly. The very important role the sodium ions play is in the hypertension. I'll just go through the fate of the sodium. See, what we studied here was that it is responsible for maintaining the osmotic pressure as well as the hydration. Besides, we studied that it is completely absorbed from the intestinal tract, and if it is present in the excess, say if excess sodium is excreted by the kidney, right, if it is excreted more than what is being absorbed, then what is going to that lead to? It will make them the ultimate kidney is a regulator of the sodium content, and 80 to 85% of sodium is reabsorbed in the glomerular filtrate. So we know what is going to happen to the sodium. Fine. Now there is a good correlation between sodium content of the tissues in the form of, say, sodium chloride and the hypertension, that is the high blood pressure. Many people around you, one or the other in your family, must be suffering from the disease of the hypertension, that is a high BP. They all are taking medicines to survive, and it is a sort of a disease which is chronic. You know what chronic disease is? Chronic diseases which is running from a longer time and which is having the to be taken medication for a longer time. Say for example, kisi ko diabetes hai, to wo kitne time se lagatar diabetic ki dawai leta rehta hai, hai na? Likewise hypertension hai ya Parkinson's disease hai, us case mein bhi patient ko dawai bahut lambe time tak leni padti hai. So what the disease they are suffering from? They are suffering from chronic disease. Now let me tell you what is the concept here. What basically happened? आपने देखा होगा कि जिनको हाई ब्लड प्रेशर रहता है, द पेशेंट्स विच आर सफरिंग फ्रॉम हाइपरटेंशन, दे टेक लो सॉल्ट डाइट, वो नमक कम लेते हैं. नमक, दैट इज योर, व्हाट इज इट? दैट इज द कॉमन सॉल्ट विच वी टेक इन आर डाइट, एंड इट्स केमिकल फॉर्मूला इज व्हाट? इट इज NaCl. ठीक है, सो NaCl जो हम अपनी डाइट में नमक लेते हैं, दैट गिव्स व्हाट इन टू आर बॉडी? दैट गिव्स क्लोराइड आयन एंड सोडियम आयन. Now this sodium ion concentration has to be maintained. इसको हमें उस लिमिट में ही मेंटेन करना है. Means that has to be absorbed in the right amount, that has to be excreted in the right amount. Fine. So what is it about the concept? That there is a good correlation between sodium content of the tissue and the hypertension. ठीक है, क्या relation है? If sodium concentration increases in the body and is not eliminated, we did what? That it is absorbed from the intestinal tract, then kidney is what? The ultimate regulator. ठीक है, यहाँ पे ये excrete होता है sodium ion, जितना absorb होना था वो हो गया. Like whatever has to be absorbed intestinal से वो absorb हो गया. Now rest is going to be excreted through the kidneys. Now if it is not eliminated, मतलब अगर वो एलिमिनेट नहीं हो रहा है, बॉडी से बाहर नहीं जा रहा है, तो क्या होगा? बॉडी में वो ज़्यादा हो जाएगा. ठीक है, अब क्योंकि सोडियम आयन इज रिस्पॉन्सिबल टू मेंटेन द ऑस्मोटिक बैलेंस, व्हाट इज गोइंग टू हैपन? इट इज गोइंग टू रिटेन द वाटर एज वेल. सी, इफ सोडियम कॉन्सेंट्रेशन इंक्रीज इन द बॉडी एंड इज नॉट एलिमिनेटेड, देन वाटर इज ऑल्सो रिटेन्ड इन द टिश्यू टू मेंटेन दैट कंसंट्रेशन, उसको नलिफाई करने के लिए, है ना. अब वाटर अगर आपने रिटेन कर लिया, इट इज गोइंग टू वॉट? इट इज गोइंग टू डिस्टर्ब द ऑस्मोटिक बैलेंस, एंड दैट वाटर दैट इज गोइंग टू लीड टू द एक्यूमुलेशन ऑफ द फ्लूइड. एक्यूमुलेशन ऑफ फ्लूइड को हम क्या कहते हैं? वी कॉल इट एज एडिमा. It is spelled as edema, or it is also spelled as OEDEMA. This is also right, and this is also right. So, what is going to happen if sodium concentration increases in the body and is not eliminated, then water is retained in the tissue to maintain that osmotic balance, which is going to lead to the edema. And this edema, the buildup of the fluid that puts in this edema puts the extra pressure on the heart. So, that is going to lead to the problem of the hypertension. Or if a patient is already suffering from the hypertension, it is going to severe the disease, the severity of the disease is going to lead to, it is going to create more complication of the patient, right? So, what is basically the treatment? How we can avoid that? We can do the treatment by taking the low salt diet, means we are going to take a lesser NaCl in the diet. We are going to take diuretics. You know what is diuretics? Diuretics. Diuretics are the agent which increases the volume as well as the frequency of the urine, right? They are going to do what? They are going to bring more urine from, to be excreted from the body. More is the urine excreted from the body, more is the sodium ion also excreted along with, theek hai? So, agar aap diuretics lete hain, to diuretics mein urine ke saath saath aapki body se NaCl bhi jo hai wo eliminate ho raha hai, theek hai? Then we have the cardiotonic drugs. Cardio is the word which is related to the heart, and cardiotonic drugs are the drugs which are going to maintain the tonicity or the proper functioning of the heart. So, in the case of the hypotension, what do? We take the drugs, say diuretics, we take cardiotonic drugs, as well as we take the low salt diet, so that sodium cation ka concentration zyada nahi ho and it is eliminated, right? So, this is all about students. This all we did. I hope you are going to just take up the lecture that we had the sodium ion. How does it lead to the sodium hypertension? Then how does the situation lead to the hyponatremia or hyponatremia? Then what are the different physiological function of the sodium ion, and we need to maintain the balance of the same? And what are the functions of the electrolyte? So this was just one of the electrolyte we studied today. Besides this, we are going to study the different electrolytes which again play the role in the muscle contraction, in the nerve impulse, in cellular signaling, in cellular messaging, in maintaining the pH balance, and in the breathing as well as the cellular transport. So, this is a very, you know, stringent condition that we have to maintain this electrolyte balance in the body with the help of our diet, so that no any homeostasis which is being maintained in our body should not be disturbed, and this mechanism or this regulatory mechanism or the balance that remains, so that we can avoid the different diseases. Now, just we did about the sodium ion, which is going to lead to what? It is going to lead to the hypertension. And in fact, there are many more ions which we are going to study in the further lectures, which again, if not balance is maintained, they are going to lead to the diseases. So, I hope you got this lecture. Just go through these slides so that you can become acquainted with it. And further, I will proceed with the different electrolytes in the further classes or in different lectures. Thank you.